بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين، والصلاة والسلام على أشرف الخلق سيد المرسلين سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. اللهم افتح علينا فتحا مبينا وارزقنا رزقا مباركا كريما. اللهم افتح علينا أبواب رحمتك وفضلك يا رب العالمين. اللهم صل وسلم وبارك على سيدنا وحبيبنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. In the name of Allah, the Beneficent, the Merciful, and may the peace and blessings of Allah Azza wa Jal be upon His Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Your brothers and sisters, assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi ta'ala wa barakatuh. Tonight's topic, brothers and sisters, revolves around a central meaning to our entire existence. It's a concept, it's a goal, it's a prize. As I mentioned, our entire lives revolve around, namely the idea of peace. It's a word, a concept that unfortunately nowadays has been given a lot of rhetoric. What's the most mentioned word that we hear of in the news, amongst people, between countries, within families? Peace. Even people say, I want some peace of mind. It's the thing most desired on this earth, yet it's the thing that eludes us the most. Imagine, brothers and sisters, if you had all means of joy available to you, materialistic means. My point is that, brothers and sisters, the thing we desire in our existence on this earth is just that moment of peace, where my mind is not feeling distressed, where I'm not feeling anxious, where I'm not feeling threatened, where I'm not afraid, and where I'm not sad over something. Isn't that what ultimately breeds a state of insecurity in our hearts and minds? Haven't you come across points in your life where there is nothing wrong in your life, yet you find your heart feeling distressed? In a blink of an eye, it switches from feeling peaceful and serene to over 1 second, because of one thought on your mind, it flips. How often does that happen? How often does it happen that when you're sitting down having a conversation with someone and everything is going well, and a thought intrudes into your mind, one thought that reminds you of some bad fortune or event in your life in the past, and you cannot get it out of your mind, and it makes you very distressed and very sad. And people will be looking at you like, you were laughing a minute ago, what happened? You say, I don't know what it is, my heart. And it feels constricted, and you have no explanation for it, and you cannot snatch that thought out of your mind. How often do you find yourself being calm, and you're smiling, and a thought from the future comes, not the past, from the future, to scare you about a possibility of losing a job, or losing your home, or of an illness that hasn't happened, or of the many possibilities that essentially promise you of misfortunes and difficulty? Isn't that happening in our minds? This war constantly happen over fear of the future and sadness over the past, and we're trapped in between these two worlds, and the mind is in a wreck, and the heart starts pumping faster, and you have no idea what's going on, and you're hoping for this train in your mind to slow down, but it can't. Wouldn't you wish for that moment to just have that moment of peace? How about physical security? How many people, their brothers and sisters, were living in the security of this place, in this country, they have no idea when the next bomb will fall on their heads? How about that feeling of insecurity and lack of peace? How many people are afraid for their bodies to be harmed? So many physical and emotional threats assault us every single day of our lives. How often do we feel that we're at peace until we see someone that we don't like? And just them showing up, their faces bring havoc and instability because of their nature. And you would say, as soon as you see them, oh my God, I wish they were not here. And you start feeling lack of peace because of their presence. Don't you come across people who really bring you that distress as soon as you see them? How about when they start speaking? And as soon as they say the first words, like, ooh, painful. Be it making fun of you, insulting you. How about sarcasm? Wallahi, brothers and sisters, we have supposedly people in positions of moral leadership, leading religious institutions perhaps, and using sarcasm as a mode of interaction with people because they need to put people in their places. Mocking people, exposing people in public to put them down. How does that make you feel? The number of things that make us feel unpeaceful on this earth cannot be counted. You're assaulted all the time, in your own mind, in your own heart, and in the environment around you. You cannot keep up. Yet it's the thing that every human being is searching for. And by Allah, dear brothers and sisters, the human being understood this. They'll say, I'll let go of all the materialistic means, but give me one moment of peace, where I don't have to worry, where my mind feels settled and my heart feels settled. Isn't that what we desire? Now Allah Azza, just as the rest of the names that we've talked about over the past few months, here He is coming to address this core need of the human being, the very reason of his existence or her existence, which is to find stability and peace of mind and heart. And here He is naming Himself with a name in which He tells me and you with a powerful message You will never find someone giving you peace but Allah. The only constant, reliable source of absolute peace is only Allah. That's why he calls himself As-Salam, the peaceful one, and the only source of peace. About what kind of peace? Is it like my or your peace? How much peace can I give you, brothers and sisters? It depends on my mood, isn't it true? Don't you notice sometimes when I'm feeling good, I'll make you feel good. But if I'm not feeling good, nobody should feel good around me. Isn't that the nature of the human being? So the state of heart and mind of, let's say, the head of the household. If he shows up from work and he's happy, alhamdulillah, he's happy today. But if the head of the household shows up after work and he is upset, oh my God, like everybody has to feel it. So our internal state is felt by others around us. So depending on your mood and your capacity, you'll be able to give peace accordingly. It depends on your level of control of yourself and your ability. How about the ability of Allah to give peace? He's peace himself, it's his nature. And he's the creator, the sovereign of the heavens and the earth. So he says to you, I am not salam, peace. I am the salam, the peace, all of peace. And you'll never get it from anybody else. And when I give you my peace, you can count on that peace as being steady, constant, and absolute. And all the experiences of peace you feel in your life, be it in your heart when you feel good, or when you feel safe physically, and you feel like, alhamdulillah, I have a job and I have means available to me, that's all from Allah. All are manifestations of the peace of Allah. So let us reflect on the precise meanings of the name As-Salam. The first meaning, when Allah says As-Salam, there is a close derivative of As-Salam, an Arabic word that says Salim. You know what Salim means? Sound. Okay. So if the table is standing on its feet and it's fine and there are no cracks in it, we call it in Arabic Salim, Salim. If it has any flaw in it, in fact, they say it's not Salim. When something is whole, when something is complete and is lacking any defect, free of defects, we call it Salim. It's close to Salam. As if Allah is telling all of us, the nature of Allah Himself, His divine nature, His divine essence is free of defect, whole and holy. You cannot find a flaw in it. That's the first meaning. Second meaning, Allah's nature and divine essence is perfect and lacking any imperfections or flaws. And it's so peaceful. So He's the one whose deeds, all of them, all of His actions are free of any imperfection and they're all peaceful and are free of any evil. Those who question Allah and He says, why, Ya Allah, did you do this to me? And why are you allowing evil, spreading evil? Do not understand who Allah is and fail to understand the word As-Salam. And it's an accusation of Allah. You're attributing imperfection to Allah. How can the creator of the heavens and the earth intend harm or intend evil for His creatures? Allah, who created mercy and love, and the heavens and the earth would wish evil, do evil for the sake of evil? Impossible. وَلَيَّادُ بِاللَّهِ Allah is free of that. So how do you explain then all that happens on this earth? What about Allah Azza when He makes someone ill? Or when He impoverishes a human being? This is similar, as we've always said before in the many examples, like a father disciplining his child. If you don't give your child the bitter medicine, when they're ill, they're not going to get well. The child doesn't understand this. And to the child, the bitter medicine is evil. Why are you making me taste this awful medicine? They have no idea what medicine does. A 3-year-old or a 4-year-old will cry. But you say you have to take it. Because you don't understand this is going to cure you. Similarly, when we transgress on this earth, when we forget about Allah, maybe He needs to make us sick. To humble us and remind us of our weakness and our need of Allah. And to slow us down a little bit. Maybe with wealth, you'll also abuse and lose your way. And Allah wants to bring you to that state of peace and to bring you to Jannah, so He might need to impoverish you, etc., etc. So there are circumstances we might understand, and there are many other events in our lives that we may not understand why Allah is doing them to us. But rest assured, Allah does not harm for the sake of harm. Allah harms to benefit. He makes someone poor to enrich them in some other way. He takes to give. He might take something away from you, but give you something better in your heart and your soul. Wouldn't you love to give up everything you have just to get Allah to be happy with you? Because that means you're going to make it to Jannah. And what is all of life if you didn't make it to Jannah? So Allah is willing to sacrifice your entire life for you to make it to Jannah. But we don't get it. As for the actions of human beings that are evil, that's their action. Allah gave us free will. In a nutshell, Allah's actions, they're free of any evil. In fact, He says in the Quran, about Himself, بِيَدِكَ الْخَيْرِ He says, remember, Allah owns the dominions. He gives and takes as He wills. And He says to all of us, say, بِيَدِكَ الْخَيْرِ O Allah, in Your hand is all goodness. Do we trust Allah's hand is all good? That whatever He does in our lives is for our good? Even if it's really harmful and painful, it's for your good. Allah doesn't want any of us, brothers and sisters, to be in permanent distress. Because the permanent distress will occur if we lost our way with Allah Azza wa Jal. So the temporary distress is necessary for you to be humbled and remember Allah Azza wa Jal. Don't you notice that we call upon Allah the most when we are in trouble? So alhamdulillah for troubled times. Wallahi. It makes you wake up perhaps in the middle of the night to pray and make dua sincerely. Maybe in other times we don't. That's why Allah Azza wa Jal puts us through these trials, and the trials will never end until we meet Allah Azza wa Jal. So Allah's objective is to make you survive, is to save you at the end, which is in the hereafter. That's what His plan is. What is your plan? Divine essence is pure, perfect, and free of imperfections, and very peaceful. His own nature is very peaceful. His deeds are free of imperfections, and are never of evil nature. And they're very peaceful as well. Third is that He delivers peace to His creation. Delivers it. He preserves them and their state of security, and protects them from harm. Physically and metaphysically. Physically and emotionally. Or spiritually. In all dimensions of our experience, we're going to find examples as to how Allah secures us. But we're just not paying attention. Let's go through some examples. Basic, as a means of illustration. But I pray to Allah that we leave today and we think some more about the manifestations of His peace on this earth. You know, when we have gone through the names of Allah, each time we said, each of the names is manifested in creation around you. Remember when we spoke of Al-Alim? That each thing around you and in your own body and outside speak of Allah's knowledge. They represent His knowledge, because who gave you your eyes? Who designed them? Allah. So the eye itself speaks of His knowledge. Like when I look at this table, I say, who's the carpenter who made this? It's really flimsy. It speaks of His knowledge. When you look at this creation, it speaks of the knowledge of Allah. Imagine His knowledge. Your own body is a walking sign of His knowledge, because it's His knowledge that allowed you to be. He designed this intricate system. He designed the clouds and made them. The sun and the moon and the distances and the gravity in your heart and your brain. He made those. So each time you look at yourself, in your motion, in your organ, at things around you, they speak to the knowledge of Allah. Similarly today, every single thing around you speaks also to the peace of Allah. Very simple examples, inshallah. Look at the location of your own organs. Where is the brain located? The command center of the human being. Remember who created it. The one who made it with His knowledge is Allah. It's such a delicate organ that is central, pivotal to your existence. You can't make a decision without your brain. You cannot feel, you cannot do anything. You cannot walk or talk. You can't live. It regulates your body, allows you to live this life. So if He just created it, and it's awesome creature, then He placed it anywhere in your body. If your brain was in your belly, what will happen? Or imagine if it was at the bottom of your body. It's not. Where did Allah place it? Top of your body. Allah secured your brain so that it's protected from any harm by placing it inside of this bone. It's a skull. But what if your brain was touching the skull directly? What will happen if I hit your head? It suffers a blow. What will happen to that spot where the hit happens? If the brain is touching the skull directly, it will still damage it. So what did Allah place between your brain and the skull? There is a fluid. If the head is hit, that spot, there is a fluid underneath it, all around. It absorbs the shock and then disperses it around the whole head. So that specific spot does not get damaged. Who designed that buffer and shock absorber but Allah, to protect your brain? Because if it's going to be subjected to harm every second, you're done. How can you even live? So to secure and protect you, He did this. Where is your heart located that is pumping all the time without you controlling the beat? Imagine if you have to pump just to keep the beats going. Allah says, no, involuntary. Because I need to secure you. You can go to sleep and it will still work, and I'm going to put it behind the cage to protect it from blows as well. What about the womb of a mother? It's at the geometrical center of a woman, in a pelvis. Total protection for a possible child. What about your spinal cord? Where does He place it? It's called the vertebral column. It's totally protected. How about your eyes? You notice that your eyes do not protrude out. Where are they sitting? In an orbit. Imagine if you get a blow on your head, on your face. If your eyes were protruding, they'll get damaged right away. But Allah secures them in a socket. That's a manifestation of His peace. To secure you. Ensure that you're safe, so that you can live your life and use your organs. What is above them? Eyelashes, eyebrows. Total protection from dirt, filth, all kinds of things. They latch onto the eyebrows and then the eyelashes. What about the liquid in your own eyes? You know what your eyes are made of? There's water inside. You know what that means? We're in winter. Theoretically, if you walk outside in sub-freezing temperature, what should happen to the water in your eyes? Freeze. It should. Imagine every time we walked outside and it's under 32, our eyes froze up. How does Allah secure your eyes from freezing? You know, if you walk outside and cold wind hits your face, what do you feel in your eyes? Tears. You know what the tears carry? Design of Allah. High concentration of salt. What does salt do? What do we put on snow? Salt. To lower the freezing point. Allah coated your eyes with the salt that you put on snow so that it doesn't freeze up when you walk outside. And it tears up more when there is wind. And not only this, He's not done. You see, we don't know about any of this. He designed it all with his, subhanAllah, miraculous abilities. And then his intent for peace for you, safety for you, to protect you from harm and allow you to live. He designed an intricate vessel system in your eyes and around it to irrigate it with warm blood, because your blood is warm. So because that blood keeps flowing and being irrigated to your eyes continuously, they never get to that cold temperature. SubhanAllah. So how many of us will think of this, say, As-Salam this time, as opposed to Al-Alim? To say, As-Salam. Look at how he protected the location of my organs. I'm standing on 2 feet. How about maintaining your balance? You know, it's all in your ears. Cochlear fluid. It's all about how the fluid, you know, if you tilt this way, I don't know, it goes up or down the level and sends a signal to the brain, and the brain alerts you to stand. If it wasn't there, you'll be falling all the time. You cannot walk. The one who reflects cannot but worship Allah, say, La ilaha illallah. And today, cannot but say, SubhanAllah, the one who brings us that security and protection and peace. He's trying to demonstrate to you so much and prove to you how much peace He wants for you. How about our bones? When you're born, your bones start growing. And growing, and growing. They stop at whatever age, 16, 17, 18. Imagine if they continue to grow. Then He orders them to stop. Now 60 years later, at the age of 60, your bone breaks. What happens to the cells that were asleep? They wake up again. Allah awakens the cells 67 years later to come back and grow and bind. And then they go back to sleep after they bind your bone. They were hibernating, dead, asleep. And Allah woke them up. The body that Allah created is like this. It heals itself. SubhanAllah. The bones will come back to life and bind on their own without you doing a thing. And so on and so forth. Endless, brothers and sisters. Imagine if you didn't have pain nerves. You cannot live. Because each time you damage an organ or a tooth and you don't feel the pain, you're going to lose all of your teeth. But He gives you these pain nerves to alert you that something is wrong. Go to the doctor. Allah Azza wa Jalla wants your safety. That's physically. And above, the clouds above us that deliver the rain, the ozone layer and the atmosphere to protect us from radiation, gravity, perfectly designed level of gravity. Imagine if it was a little bit stronger or lighter. If it's lighter, we'll fly off of this earth. How about if it's a little bit stronger? You can't walk on earth. Perfectly designed for your own safety. The distance of the sun, the distance of the moon, everything delicately planned by Allah to ensure your safety. Now non-physically. Allah, brothers and sisters, gives us nourishment and protection for our bodies. Gives us food and drink. And then the system in your own body and around you to ensure your safety. But is that Allah's plan for you only? No. He put the body on earth. It needs to be sustained and nurtured and preserved. So He is As-Salam, the one that does that for you. What about your heart and soul? The one who take care of the bodies will also take care of the soul and the heart. Isn't that what yearns for peace the most? Because even if your body has all the food and the drink and the security, if your soul and your heart are aching, and if they're afraid or distressed, it doesn't matter what you have. So Allah says, I'll secure your heart and your soul. So what does He say in the Quran? يَهْدِي مَنِ اتَّبَعَ رُضْوَانَهُ سُبُلَ السَّلَامِ He says, He will guide to His ways of peace the ones who seek the pleasure of Allah. Surah Al-Ma'idah, verse 16. Allah will guide, will show, will allow you to see it, and will help you on the path. The path of peace, He says. The ways of peace for your heart and your soul. And your entire existence. He says you're going to find peace in them. And no other way to deliver you to peace. To make you feel safe. To make you feel settled. To make you feel serene. But my ways. But who will be guided to them? Only the ones who seek the pleasure of Allah. So others will miss those ways. And what do they end up doing? Struggling in this life. How many people have we seen, brothers and sisters, who do not know Allah? They have everything. Yet they end up committing suicide. What is it that would lead a human being who has all physical pleasures to want to kill themselves? But that their hearts and souls did not find peace. They're in a state of disturbance and turbulence. No medicine can fix it. They'll go to doctors. It doesn't work. Because the only doctor for it is Allah. Only Allah Azza wa Jal. So He says in the Quran, طه ما أنزلنا عليك القرآن لتشقى. Allah says, طه. We have not revealed this Quran for you so that you become burdened. People are confused. People do not understand. They think this Qur'an and this guidance is to burden them and make life difficult. Because we can no longer pursue our desires. He says, no. This is to fix you up. To settle you, make you feel serene. It is to make you feel safe, if you understood. It is to erase the confusion. Doesn't Allah say in the Qur'an, فَمَنْ تَبِعَ هُدَايَ فَلَا يَضِلُّ وَلَا يَشْقَى Look at what He says in this verse. Guaranteed from your Lord. Whoever follows my way, my guidance, whatever I've asked you to do, there are two things guaranteed for you. لَا يَضِلُّ You will never go astray. Imagine if Allah was not in the picture, how will we live our lives? If we didn't know what's right and wrong, if we didn't know how to treat people, if we didn't know the path to Jannah, how will we know how to succeed? How will we know how to live? Impossible. So Allah says, whoever follows my guidance will never go astray. That means there's no confusion. By Allah, brothers and sisters, if there's no confusion in your mind, do you need anything else? Isn't confusion a source of anxiety? Doubt. You know what doubt does to people? It drives them insane. That's one of the primary sources of anxiety. To be confused and not know the answer. Allah says, I have an answer for you. And it is the answer, the truth. Just knowing that by itself, doesn't it settle you down? That's one. No going astray. What is the second? وَلَا يَشْقَى And will never be distressed or miserable. Allah's telling you, my path will guarantee you'll never be miserable in this life. Let alone the hereafter. Even on this earth, you'll never be miserable. So if you cannot go astray and you're never miserable, what else do you need? But how many of us see the guidance of Allah? And how many of us run away from the guidance of Allah, thinking it's a burden? And wherever we run away from it, what happens? Your heart and your soul are in a state of torture. And you get further confusion. And we start mistaking our behavior, our ill deeds, for being good deeds. We start confusing truth and falsehood. Allah says it in the Quran. The shaitan starts making your behavior attractive. How many people lie and they think it's a good thing? They justify it. How many people mock others and they say, you know, they needed to hear it. So you start making the action attractive to yourself because you're far from the Qur'an. The Qur'an humbles you, reminds you of Allah. The human being far from the Qur'an is far from his own soul. And you start thinking the truth is falsehood and the falsehood is truth. Do you think the people who kill, they think it's false? No, they think it's the right thing to do. They don't rise to that level out of nowhere. It's a journey. Sin after sin after sin. And being further and further from the Qur'an and Allah until their hearts become sealed. They can no longer see. That's why they commit what they commit, brothers and sisters. That's why people start behaving like animals. Because the soul is shut off from the source of light. So Allah says the light that lights up the room for you to make you see is the Qur'an. The further you're away from it, the more blind you are. You cannot see anymore. Don't you even see people around us who yell and scream? And they give people a hard time? They have no idea what they're doing is bad. They're blind. Now when you come to the Qur'an, it settles you, it soothes you. It reminds you of the one who created the heavens and the earth. It allows you to see the truth as truth. Very simple equation, dear brothers and sisters. So whoever follows the guidance of Allah, when Allah says, say the truth, you say the truth. Don't we see that saying the truth gets you out of trouble? Everything He tells us to do guarantees our protection and safety. And the safety of people in our lives. Love and you'll get love. Hate and you'll get hate. Isn't that part of the legislation of Allah Azza wa Jal? Protect the rights of people. Don't steal their wealth. Don't violate their rights. Don't abuse them. If you abuse them, what does it do to your own heart? Do you notice that whenever we oppress someone, who's the first victim? Your own heart. It'll be in pain. Allah will constrict it. Will make you feel in a state of torment. When you insult someone, don't you feel the pain? Now if the heart gets to a point where it no longer feels pain, that means it's dead. So Allah says, you want to feel at peace? Just follow my way. Follow Allah, do what He asks you to do. Link up with His words of guidance. Treat people well. Pray to Allah. It'll settle you down. And your heart will be at peace. Even if people violate you. So following the guidance of Allah delivers peace to you in three dimensions. First, peace with yourself. Your own nature, brothers and sisters. Your soul and your heart are created from Allah. And they belong to Allah. They only settle with Allah. So do you notice that wherever you pray, wherever you mention the word of Allah, the name of Allah, or you're with the Qur'an, do you notice that your own soul starts dancing? It starts feeling well. It's as if you found your own soul. Do you notice that when we're far from Allah, we're almost like far from our own hearts? Sometimes we hear people even saying, I don't know what's wrong with me. They're confused about their own internal condition. As if they're alienated from their own souls. Their souls are in a state of disturbance. And they can no longer read their own hearts. Though their heart tells them something, they go do the opposite. Their souls are screaming for help, and then they go get drunk. That's a soul screaming, and the person carrying it cannot understand. So you become alienated from your soul, and you see the signs of that disturbance in the behavior. So when you follow the guidance of Allah, Allah says you'll have peace with yourself. Now if you're at peace with your soul, it was because you were at peace with Allah. Now if I'm at peace with Allah, and I'm at peace with myself, that means Allah will make sure that my heart is at peace. My soul is at peace. If my heart is at peace and my soul are at peace, I'll be at peace with creation around me. Three dimensions of peace. Pay attention to people around us. Might be us. Wherever your soul is struggling, you notice that it manifests in your behavior and you create disturbance in people around you. Because you're not at peace with Allah. And you're not at peace with Allah, you have no peace with yourself. And when you're not at peace with yourself, there's no peace with others around you. What have we done? We've broken all the rules of Allah. And that's why we have so much injustice. Wars going on. Not only wars at a global level between countries, but wars in our own homes, brothers and sisters. Somebody does something wrong to us in our families, we lash out at them. We argue. We debate. We practice the most hazardous things to our lives. We eat unhealthy, speak words that disturb, behave in ways that disturb. People around us get drunk, they go on drugs, they flip their night into day into night. Even that, subhanAllah, speaking of manifestations of Allah's peace, Ajal has designed with ourselves, speaking of night and day. Allah designed you with a system that delivers absolute peace to you, physically speaking. There is a gland, it's behind the ear, very small, that releases melatonin. I've read about this melatonin. Among the things that it does is that it also fights oxidation. The hormone is only released at night. Apparently, the gland becomes more active with the release of this at night. And it's only released, not only at night, when it's dark. Automatically, there is a release of that hormone. And it's supposed to fight oxidation in your body, which produces cancer. So if you fight oxidation, you cut back on, inshallah, the possibility of cancer. What happens to people at night? They're supposed to go to sleep and be in darkness so that the gland starts functioning. At least as far as that hormone is concerned. What do you see people doing nowadays? Staying up, lights, noise, and it's as if daylight. What happens to the system inside? It goes in a state of havoc. The hormones are not released in their proper time. And you've seen the evidence of it in terms of illnesses. Wallahi, brothers and sisters, perfect system. Do you know the Prophet ﷺ used to go to sleep when? After Isha. When does he wake up? Last third of the night, at least. Perfectly designed around even the hormonal system. That's why he was the healthy man that he was. But we're not in consonance with our own bodies even. Because we have failed to understand the ways of peace. Physically speaking, don't you notice your mind is clearest in that hour before Fajr time? You're clearest. You think best. Allah spoke about it in the Quran. Something in nature around us changes where your mind becomes sharper. You see better. You think better. The tongue is more articulate. And your level of comprehension is better is our words from the Quran. When was the Prophet up during those times? SubhanAllah. Your adrenaline is higher in the morning and it slows down as the day progresses. Perfectly designed for you to get up early, go to work and come down, slow down and Isha, hit the bed. You'll be healthy. Look at how far we are from that health. Because we violated the peaceful ways of Allah Azza wa Jal. But most importantly, dear brothers and sisters, is that the awareness of Allah Azza wa Jal is the only way to deliver peace to the heart and the soul. For Allah Azza wa Jal said, I breathe into you, speaking to Adam from my own spirit. Allah created that soul and breathed it into Adam alayhi salam. That soul came from Allah and it will never settle but with Allah. So you can seek all therapies. The heart, dear brothers and sisters, will never feel peace or serenity if it's not thinking of Allah Azza wa Jal. So pay attention to what Allah says in the Quran. أَلَا بِذِكْرِ اللَّهِ تَطْمَئِنُّ الْقُلُوبِ Manifestation of His peace. He says, your hearts that are beating fast, that are feeling anxious and you have no idea why they're anxious or distressed or worried, all they have to do is mention the name of Allah. Instantly, they'll come to peace. Because who created the heart? Allah. Who molds the heart? Allah. Isn't He the one who says, I make you laugh or cry? I'll make that to your heart. I'll make it tick the right tick or be miserable. It mentions my name, the name of Allah. It remembers Allah. Allah instantly heals the heart. Natural remedy for it. Because that's the nature of the heart and the soul, brothers and sisters. It will not find peace but with Allah. In fact, the utterance of the name of Allah, we've talked a lot about the name of Allah before. It has spiritual blessings and physical blessings as well. Allah says to us, say Bismillah, the name of Allah, before you eat or drink. Or you enter a place or have a conversation, say Bismillah. Is it just to remind you of Allah? There's more, brothers and sisters. First, it sets your intentions, reminds you of Allah, but there are even physical benefits we're not aware of. Muslim scientists dumped some experiments on slaughtered meat that had the name of Allah mentioned on it. Bismillah. And some slaughtered meat that didn't have the name of Allah mentioned. They noticed a different color in the meat itself and different levels of microbes and bacteria between the two meats. That meat was healthier. We haven't seen the blessings yet, brothers. We do not know. You mentioned the word of Allah, it blesses whatever you're doing and blesses the thing that you're doing. Not only, as I said, spiritually, but physically as well. We're totally unaware of this. Invoke His name. You're invoking the name of the Creator of the heavens and the earth. It brings direct peace to whatever it is that you're doing. Teach your children, brothers and sisters. Say Bismillah as much as you can. It brings peace to the experience that you're doing. But believe in what you're saying. And realize the blessing of it. The word flows out of your tongue without you even sealing your lips. Allah makes it flow. There are no difficult letters in the word Allah. Don't you notice when you say something, just subhanAllah, soothes your heart? Wallahi, brothers and sisters, just sit and spend time with the utterance of the word Allah, 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 and you'll see what will happen to your heart. How many of us do this when we're feeling distressed? How many of us just turn on the television when we're feeling distressed just to kind of forget or start talking to people, but forget the most obvious and direct means of healing the heart, which is to sit down away from everybody and remember the name of Allah. Trusting it will heal you, inshallah it will heal. أَلَا بِذِكْرِ اللَّهِ تَطْمَئِنُّ الْقُلُوبِ You'll feel the mercy of Allah. Wallahi, it will open the doors of the mercy of Allah. And when the doors of mercy of Allah open, that's the only door you need. Allah says it, if I open that door for you, and it opens up, the generous bounty of Allah comes down, His mercy. Even if you're in trouble, and the conditions didn't change, just you feeling the mercy of Allah will make you feel good. That's all you need. Even if all other doors are closed, and if the door of mercy is closed, and all the doors of this dunya, this world are open for you, just as those celebrities and people are well off, so well off, they have everything, but they don't have Allah, at the end you see their condition. Because they don't have the mercy of Allah. It's the treasure. And you say Bismillah, you open the treasures of the mercy of Allah Azza wa Jalla. But you need to trust and appreciate what Allah Azza wa Jalla is giving you. So the remembrance of Allah brings peace to your heart and your soul. These are the ways of peace. What else? Quran. Isn't Allah the one who says, وَنُنَزِّلُ مِنَ الْقُرْآنِ مَا هُوَ شِفَاءُ وَرَحْمَةٌ لِلْمُؤْمِنِينَ He says, guaranteed, if you guys would understand, these are powerful healing words, divine words, brothers and sisters. Allah does not change His words. It's the Qur'an. And they were sent down to us from the heavens. Invitation from Allah to use His own words, divine words. We're lucky that we can say them. You're lucky that your mouth is able to mention these words. Allah allowed your tongue to say those words in the Qur'an. Allah says, in those words, if you were just to see, are mercy and a healing for those who believe. Just as with the remembrance of Allah. How many of us when we're distressed, when we're feeling burdened, when life is so tough on us and people are giving us a hard time, and you're so tired, and you just want a moment of peace, just go to the Qur'an and open it, and say, here is peace, and serenity, and healing. All I have to do is just read and connect. And pray to Allah to open my heart. And by Allah, brothers and sisters, you read those words, the divine words of Allah, feeling the blessing of Allah and saying, Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, in the name of Allah, the most gracious, the most merciful, you're going to open the doors of mercy. Mercy and healing. And you're not going to leave that experience without feeling better. Guaranteed from Allah. How many of us take a few moments with the Quran every day? By Allah, brothers and sisters, when are we going to wake up for this? When are we going to realize and learn the lesson? Is it in the future? How many of us are still postponing our project, the project of our life, the Qur'an, it's your life. Remember, without the Qur'an, what did Allah say? You're going to go astray, for sure. It doesn't mean if you're not a Muslim. If you're away from the Qur'an, if the Qur'an is on the shelf, and you don't engage the Qur'an, which is the sustenance of your soul, guaranteed two things. You're going to be astray, you're going to be confused. You're not going to see truth as truth, or falsehood as falsehood. You're going to be confused, brothers and sisters. You're going to make a lot of mistakes and errors, and you think you're doing okay. You're not going to be at peace. Neither with Allah, nor with yourself, nor with creation. Even if you think you're alright. How engaged are we with the Qur'an, brothers? Healing words of Allah. But we have so many barriers between us and the Qur'an. And we don't connect, we don't appreciate the Qur'an. If we start appreciating the Qur'an, wallahi, brothers and sisters, you'll bring the Qur'an, place it close to your chest and you say, Alhamdulillah, I have this. The words of Allah are with me. What else do you need? Healing. And you think Allah made you hold it as an accident? He wants you to have it. He delivered to you. So many people on earth are deprived of billions. Yet you're one of the few that have understood what this message is about. The problem is many of us understood it and said, I'm just too busy. And what are we missing in the process? Our own healing. The light, dear brothers and sisters. Quran, Quran, Quran. Wallahi, it delivers energy to you. Allah says, رُوحًا مِنْ عِنْدِنَا about the Quran. It's a spirit and an energy from Allah. It actually gives you energy. And it's witnessed by Allah whenever you read it. And it's witnessed by the angels. It elevates your soul and your heart. It makes it hover around the throne of Allah. Remembrance of Allah and Quran. So I'm giving you now the means of peace that Allah gave to us in His guidance. You use those, you're going to be in a state of peace. Inshallah, guaranteed. By the Creator of the heavens and the earth. We talked about the expression Bismillah. Bismillah before everything, brothers and sisters. It brings peace. Before you read, before you eat, before you drink, before you begin a conversation, before you start any act, before you enter a room, before you start a meeting, before you start thinking, Bismillah. What did you just do? Invoke Allah, the Creator, the Powerful, the Source of Peace. Do you think your thoughts will be bad now? They cannot be. It sets your intention. It invokes Allah. It recruits Him to your help. With His peace, He comes. Your heart will be at peace. It will think better, inshallah. And your deed will be blessed by the will of Allah. So remembrance of Allah, Quran, Bismillah. How about Salah? What did the Prophet ﷺ say? the pleasure of my eyes and my soul was in that salah. It's connecting with the source of peace. It ascends with your soul to the heavens, brothers and sisters. It's a time with Allah. What do we do in the salah? It's all remembrance, dhikr, Quran, glorifications. And these are all expressions of peace. So Allah within this unit of salah is making you experience things that settle your heart and your soul. Because it's with its creator. And when your soul is with its creator, it's at home. And when it's at home, you feel good. The home of your soul is with Allah. And in the salah, it finds it. How do we leave the salah? In the same condition. No peace. Why? Because Allah never entered our hearts in the salah. Because we're thinking of everyone but Allah. Brothers, sisters, if the salah is done right, wallahi will be transformed human beings. You'll be giants in your souls and in your hearts on this earth. You'll transform earth. If we comprehended the treasure called salah, treasure from the heavens, Allah delivered it as a gift through the Prophet ﷺ to all of us. It changes our lives completely, but we have no idea what it means. And we race into it and out of it. At the end of the salah, what do we say? It captures the essence of the entire experience. What do we end it with? Salah. You're using the word salam to end it, as if to say, I just entered the most peaceful experience of my life. And now that my heart found Allah, peace, my heart is at peace, so I exit with peace. I greet the angels, as if I'm also greeting all of creation with peace. And when you say salamu alaykum, what should you be exuding? Spirit of peace, I just found it. But how do we leave the salah? Really with peace? Or with mind still straddled with the stresses of this world? Because it never entered into the peace with Allah in the salah. It was never there. The soul never ascended. That's why we live in those conditions that we are. So we end it with As-salamu alaykum wa rahmatullah. Peace be upon you and the mercy of Allah. What are we taught by the Prophet ﷺ to say right after the salah? Astaghfirullah al-azim 3 times. I seek forgiveness of Allah 3 times. Learn it, brothers and sisters. Astaghfirullah al-azim, astaghfirullah al-azim, astaghfirullah al-azim. And you're not done with peace. Allah continues to remind you what your experience was about. Allahumma anta as-salam. Wa minka as-salam. Tabarakta ya dal-jalal al-ikram. There's a purpose why you say this. So you say, Ya Allah, out of all the names of Allah, you say, Oh Allah, anta as-salam. You are the peaceful one. Allahumma anta as-salam. Wa minka, and from you is peace. All peace. And I just experienced it. What is it reminding you? Allah, that from Him is peace. So it sets your orientation, your destination to Allah. As if to say, Ya Allah, I'm finding peace from you throughout my experience on earth. I can't wait until I see you. Because when I see you, I'll find complete peace. So when you say, Allahumma anta salam, wa minka salam, tabarakta, glory to you, ya the possessor, al-jalali wal-ikram, honor and glory. Allahumma anta salam, wa minka salam, tabarakta, ya the jalali wal-ikram. Brothers and sisters, an expression like no other. Fixes your vision and your ambition and your dreams on Allah. And makes you realize there's no peace but from Allah. And Allah is my destination. On earth I get to Him through the salah and the Quran. But one day I'm praying for a real meeting with Allah. Being in His divine presence, for it's all peace. I can't wait until I get to Allah. This earth is nothing but a pathway. Every time you say Allahumma anta salam wa minka salam, tabarakta ya dhal jalali wal ikram, you're hoping to see Allah. Supposedly. But how do we say it? Is the heart aware of what it just said? Maybe, maybe not. If you're aware, say Alhamdulillah Rabbil Alameen. For Allah setting you up for something that we'll talk about shortly, that we'll inshallah address revolving around this expression. What else should we do or say? Allah teaches us. This doesn't exist in other religions, brothers and sisters. Or they lost this tradition. When you greet your brothers and sisters, what do you say? Assalamu alaikum. Peace. Remember peace with Allah. The whole objective of Islam is to nurture a sound heart. A heart at peace. Because it found Allah. So it has peace with Allah. Peace with itself. And as such, I have peace with you. So I'm going to start my interaction with you with peace be upon you. Brothers and sisters, how many of us say Assalamu alaikum to each other and they start arguing? Assalamu alaikum. We're so far from this expression. You know what you're saying when you say Assalamu alaikum? This is a covenant. Agreement. I'm telling you, I'm praying for you for peace. Assalamu alaikum is a wish. Prayer. That I wish upon you, I convey to you peace, I approach you with peace. I'm declaring to you my intention. And I wish you peace, my intention, don't worry about them. Feel secure around me, peace. So you'll never hear from me anything that disturb you or any action. You should feel totally secure around me. That's the Muslim brothers and sisters. People feel secure about them. And I'm here I am assuring you of this with my greeting, Assalamu alaikum, not hello and hi. Hello and hi doesn't say much. No, I'm giving you my peace. Assalamu alaikum, not done. Wa rahmatullah, and the mercy of Allah. So the one who understands this, brothers and sisters, cannot have bad intentions. The one who says and understands this expression has signed a covenant with Allah and says nothing but peace to people around them. and nothing but assurance and nothing but pleasure comes out of them. No deeds that they do can be of evil nature. They cannot make people feel unsettled or feel unsafe or feel anxious. All in Assalamu Alaikum. How close or far are we from Assalamu Alaikum? Real Assalamu Alaikum, brothers and sisters. What should come with it is love and affection and mercy. Think about Assalamu Alaikum when you say to your brother or sister or to your family or to your children or to your spouse or to your parents. And Allah's going to hold you to it. Why did you say to them Assalamu Alaikum? And they made them feel horrible. Or you insulted them. Or you mocked them. Or you put them down. Or you stripped hope away from their hearts. You just said Assalamu Alaikum. This is our faith, dear brothers and sisters. It became a cliche almost to say Islam peace. We lost touch with this. Wallahi, it is in every aspect. But we Muslims have lost the peace in it. And we don't exude peace because we don't have peace. We lost the divine guidance of Allah. Wallahi, brothers and sisters, it's all peace and love and affection. The Prophet himself, listen to what he says. This is very serious hadith. I pray to Allah that we Muslims understand how serious this is. The Prophet says, "Al-Muslimu man salima al-Muslimuna min lisanihi wa yadihi." He said, the Muslim, on only this is a Muslim, is the one who other Muslims feel safe around and secure around and feel safe from their tongues and their hands. What is he saying? If a Muslim hurts you with their tongue through an insult, through lying to you, through putting you down, through mocking you, disrespecting you with their tongue, they're not a Muslim. They're far from that thing called Islam. Let alone hurting you physically. How about threatening you? Not a Muslim. At that point when he threatens you, he's not a Muslim. Because he's farthest from the spirit of Allah. Spirit of peace. Serious hadith. It's an authentic hadith. He says, no one will believe. No one will believe. No one will believe. If their neighbor do not feel safe around them. This is the beauty of our faith. People need to feel secure around you. Do people feel safe around you? We know some people don't feel safe around us. They get scared when we show up. And how many people do you know that others feel scared when they are in their presence because of what they're going to say or how they're going to look at them? You feel unsafe. If you feel unsafe around somebody or the people feel unsafe around you, question your heart. There's a problem. And if people feel good around you and they feel safe, inshallah, inshallah, you're close to Allah. Be happy about this. Before I proceed, I want to spend a few seconds with this. Allah not only says, the real believer says Assalamu Alaikum and means it, and gives peace to everybody around them with their mouth, their words and their actions. But when they walk on earth, they also walk with peace. They're so gentle even on earth. يَمْشُونَ عَلَى الْأَرْضِ هَوْنَا. These are the servants of the merciful, brothers and sisters. Not only are they showing creation around them, but even earth, when they walk on it, they walk humbly. They're worried about earth itself. Imagine how much peace they bring. Gentle. And when somebody says something nasty, then they greet them back with Salaamu Alaikum. Because they don't want to disturb themselves. So no matter how much people insult, give them a hard time, salam, peace. These are the servants of the merciful. Living the whole meaning of peace. They talk peace, walk with peace, feel peace, say peaceful things. Their emotions are all peaceful. And their intentions are all peaceful. And they demonstrate it with Assalamu Alaikum. Really, they're living the meaning of Assalamu Alaikum. So Allah's divine essence is free of imperfections, peaceful. His deeds are peaceful. He delivers peace to us physically, as we've said. And then gives us the paths and the ways to peace, to live peacefully, spiritually, and in our hearts. Through the guidance of the Qur'an, through the remembrance of Allah, through the salah, and then to exercise it with creation around us. Finally, he says, you followed my guidance, which points you to the path of peace. You lived with peace. It's not over. Remember, Allahumma anta as-salam wa minka as-salam. We live this peace with Allah's guidance, but life ends at the end. So is that over? What if Allah made us live in peace, but we die and it's over? How good is that? Allah says, you see, it's not the end. It's the beginning of a journey. So Allah says in the Quran, وَاللَّهُ يَدْعُو إِلَى دَارِ السَّلَامِ. Pay attention to what He calls it. Deliberately chosen words. Allah says in this beautiful verse in Surah Yunus, and Allah invites you. Allah Himself is inviting you to a place called Darus Salam. It's His home. The home that Allah built for the believers. What did He call it here? Not Jannah. A better term even. Dar. Dar means house of peace. What does that mean about Jannah? If it's house of peace. Remember all the opposite meanings to peace? It has everything you desire and wish for. In Jannah, when you have everything fulfilled and you have all the delights and the joys and the companionship and house and the shelter and the food and the drink that you desire. You remember about the thoughts? They could come and disturb you. Do you remember that human being that can show up and flip your mood? Does that happen in Jannah? Allah cleanses your heart completely from any rancor. So never in Jannah will you encounter a moment when you're feeling down. There's no such thing as somebody showing up and their face is like, oh, I don't want to see them now. I'm enjoying, I'm having a good time with the angels here. Why are you showing up? There's no such thing in Jannah like this. Allah ensures everything in Jannah is peaceful. So to the extent where the words you hear, لا يسمعون فيها لغوا ولا تأثيم, even the words you hear are never vain. It's all melodious words that send nothing but peace to your heart, delight, joy. No thought, feeling or emotion can ever be disturbing in Jannah. Total peace. It's the peace of Allah culminating in his house. So he says, I'm calling to it. Who wants to come in? Wallahi, brothers and sisters, who's going to turn this down? Unfortunately, many of us are turning down the invitation. But he says to get to that house of peace, you have to live where in peace? Here. So the path to the house of peace goes through a path of peace on this earth. And it's only the path of the Qur'an, which will ensure your heart is sound and ready for the house of peace. So the house of peace wants pure people in it. So we're going to be cleansed in the process. We have a lot of impurities. It's okay. Allah purifies us. But it's all to get us ready for the house of peace. So that you can live in peace there. No one but a creature of peace will be in that paradise, brothers and sisters. Darus Salam. SubhanAllah, brothers and sisters, to illustrate to you how much peace Allah wants from you, that if you indeed walk the path of peace on this earth, with the guidance of Allah, as soon as you die, the first thing you see is angels greeting you with Assalamu Alaikum. Now remember when I said human beings, when they greet you with Assalamu Alaikum, most likely they're not really meaning it. When the angels say Assalamu Alaikum, they're representatives of Allah. You will find nothing but peace when we carry you. So when they deliver to you, don't worry, don't grieve, and don't be sad. Assalamu Alaikum means you're going to find nothing but peace from this moment onward. Because they're angels speaking the truth from Allah. So their Assalamu Alaikum is different than our Assalamu Alaikum. Allah says in the Quran, فَسَلَامٌ لَكَ مِنْ أَصْحَابِ الْيَمِينِ. And the people of the right in the hereafter will greet you with salams. And at the door of Jannah, you get in with greetings of سَلَامٌ عَلَيْكُمْ سَلَامٌ عَلَيْكُمْ. Enter with peace. Enter with peace. But Allah says it's not enough. You got the assurances and the glad tidings of peace from the angels with their greetings. The people of the right greeting you with peace. There's one last salutation that is left to ensure you really get it, that you're going to find nothing but peace. The salutation of Allah Himself. So Allah says in Surah Yasin, Salamun qawlan min Rabbir Rahim. So Allah says you're going to hear the salutation of peace from me directly, not through my angels, from the Lord of the heavens and the earth when He sends His peace directly. Now He already gave us His peace in His house, in the delights and the pleasures. But He's going to now deliver to you the word itself to make you understand peace. Imagine Allah greeting you with peace. How can you have anything but peace? You just found Allah Azza wa Jal, and indeed, dear brothers and sisters, it's the ultimate and final guarantee and stamp from Allah that your life will be eternally peaceful from now. You arrive to the source of peace. And indeed, as we heard, and we'll conclude with this, the people of Jannah, dear brothers and sisters, who really struggled on this path of peace, they really tried their best on this earth to live with the guidance of Allah. Even with the lows that they've experienced, it's okay. Allah will pull you up. They tried their best on this earth. After they make it to the house of peace, and they enter peacefully with the greetings of the angel, and they have the delights of Jannah all around them. We hear from the hadith that a caller will come and say, oh, people of Jannah, come to be receiving this special reward. And the people of Jannah will say, what is that thing that is waiting for us? We already have everything. And special vehicles will come and bring the people of Jannah to this special location. And as they're sitting there, enjoying themselves, not anxious, suddenly a light shines upon them. And they suddenly hear the voice of Allah. And what is the first word they hear? O people of Jannah. Imagine Musa when he heard the greeting of Allah. Ya Musa, inni ana rabbuk. I'm your Lord. I mean, it's the voice of Allah. We're going to hear it. So he says, O people of Jannah, salamun alaykum, salamun alaykum. Imagine if you hear and you know it's the voice of Allah and he's telling you, assalamu alaykum. Imagine how much you've talked to Allah on earth and now you hear his voice in Jannah. Now what do the people of Jannah say? They're not going to say, alaykum assalam. How can you say to the source of peace, upon you is peace? Now the people of Jannah were the ones who say Salamu Alaikum here. And after each salah, training themselves with Allahumma anta salam, wa minka salam, tabarakta wa ta jalal ikram, dreaming of the moment where they finally arrive to the source of peace. After each salah, I know I said that thing. Here's the moment of truth. And I heard As-salamu. Finally, you're living for that moment to be greeted with peace from Allah Himself when He says Assalamu Alaikum. And all the believers in unison answer back by saying, Allahumma anta salam, wa minka salam, tabarakta ya jalal ikram. All these moments you've been saying it, culminated in this moment. Allah says, all these times you've been dreaming, you know you've been rehearsing with this expression, and you really wanted it, Allah will not disappoint you, brothers and sisters. If after each salah you're saying it, Allah inshallah will make you say it. Allah doesn't fail, brothers and sisters. You're treating with the generous, the merciful. If you find yourself saying this, and you mean it and you're sincere with it and you dream and yearn for that moment with Allah when you exchange the salutations with Him, by Allah, inshallah, by the will of Allah, it will happen. Allah will not disappoint nor deprive. But it's up to your heart. What does the heart want? Allah? Allah will give you Himself. Peace. Not only His house of peace, but Himself, which is higher than anything in Jannah. And then He'll ask the people of Jannah, after greeting them, people of Jannah, ask me, this day is the day of the extra reward, just ask and I'll give you. People of Jannah will say, oh Allah, what else are we going to ask for? We have everything. You've given us everything. Every fulfillment of every wish. Our families are here. Peace is here. Eternal. He says, oh people of Jannah, ask. They say, oh Allah, just be happy with us. Allah says, if I was not happy with you, would I have entered you into my house of peace, to my Jannah? People of Jannah, today is the day of the extra reward. Ask. And Allah will make all their hearts cohere around one wish. Because remember, their hearts are all in unison. Allah will make our hearts as such. Souls will harmonize. All turn to Allah and they say, oh Allah, we ask you for one. Show us your face. And instantly, without a word from Allah, without a word, He already greeted them, the veil is removed. Slowly. Now Allah knows how the veil looks like and how it will be removed. But imagine a curtain opening up. They've already seen the light of Allah. Suddenly the curtain opens and directly in front of their face, who displays Himself? Allah Himself. In real form. Creator of the heavens and the earth. The one that you've been worshipping, prostrating to, calling upon, remembering, reading His words, learning about, spending time with. Finally get to see Him. Who built this whole thing for you to be happy. Who tells you you finally arrived at me. Imagine how I'm going to treat you right now. The Prophet ﷺ says, the people of Jannah start looking at the face of Allah. There's nothing as captivating as the face of Allah in its beauty. And he says they will not want to take their eyes off of Him. They'll forget about everything in Jannah, including their own spouses, children, pleasures. They'll forget. They'll say, I just don't want to take my face off of Him. I want to keep looking. And looking, even if it's an eternal look. If you see the face of Allah, you will not want to take your eyes off of Him, even if there is nothing else. That's what's waiting for the believer. And it is that moment that captures all the peace we've been living for, brothers and sisters. That's what Allah is calling for. Indeed, brothers and sisters, we conclude with one thing. This name really reminds you of how much Allah loves you. He is already protecting you on this earth, securing you with all the things that we've talked about, providing for you the means to arrive at that peace physically. We've talked about examples. Spiritually, for your heart to settle and be serene. And He says, if you do these things and conform and really try to submit to this path, follow it. Force yourself. You're going to feel peaceful here. Even if life is difficult. But when it's over, the journey begins of peace. Angels will greet you with peace and you'll finally arrive at the house of peace. And you'll get to meet and see the source of peace, Allah has said. So brothers and sisters, leave here tonight, first of all, thinking of As-Salam. And remembering to say the few things we've learned. First, if your heart is unsettled, remember Allah's name. Pick up His book and read. It'll soothe you. Salah, source of peace. Bismillah, source of peace for every activity. People around you, want peace with them so that you can find peace with Allah. As-Salamu Alaikum and mean it. As-Salamu Alaikum, commitment from me, I'm going to show you nothing but peace. And after your salah, what do you say? Let's remember this dua, brothers and sisters. Allahumma anta as-salam. Wa minka as-salam. Tabarakta yada jalal ikram. Except that we want to say it differently this time. We don't want to say it as a ritual. We want to say it, inshallah, with a dream in our minds. Oh Allah, I'm saying it right now. I'm rehearsing. Because, oh Allah, I want to say it when I get greeted with your salam. Ya Allah, do not deprive me of this. Say it with a dua. It itself is a dua, but say it with another dua in your heart. If your heart is thinking of that dream and wishing it and crying for it, inshallah, Allah will give it to you. Picture yourself standing there in Jannah. In your imagination, there's a veil and the veil gets removed. Don't think of Allah. You can't think of Allah. No matter how much we think. But it's if Allah is greeting you, you hear His voice, and you say, Allahumma anta salam wa minka salam, tabarak, ya da jal ikram. You've fulfilled the best thing you can fulfill on this earth. Your mission is complete. Wallahi, brothers and sisters. But watch your heart, watch your behavior, watch your words. If you're not living in peace with others around you, brothers and sisters, that means that soul and heart is not at peace with Allah. And we've talked about the means of peace. Get out, brothers and sisters, and invoke Allah with the word of as-salam. Ya Salam, send me your peace. We ask Allah Azza wa Jalla to convey to us His peace. We ask Allah Azza wa Jalla to make us among the people of peace. We ask Allah Azza wa Jalla to fill our hearts and souls with peace. And to make us among those who follow the guidance to the peace. We ask Allah Azza wa Jalla to make us among those who love His words, who love the Quran, who love His remembrance. We ask Allah Azza wa Jalla to make us among those who get to see His face. And who get to see the face of the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. To make us among those who find peace on this earth, in our lives, with people around us. And when we finally face Allah Azza wa Jalla and see Him, Allahumma ameen, Allahumma aghfir lana warhamna wa'fu anna wa tawalla amrana wa ahsin khalasana, Allahumma ahdina ila subuli salam, Allahumma ahdina ila subuli salam. اللهم اهدنا إلى سبل السلام واجعلنا من أهل السلام وأدخلنا دار السلام ولا تحرمنا من لذة النظر إلى وجهك الكريم. وصلي اللهم على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. جزاكم الله خيرا والسلام عليكم ورحمة الله. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله. Say السلام عليكم differently. At least one thing tonight. Wallahi, brothers and sisters, think about the meaning of السلام عليكم. And Allahumma anta السلام ومنك السلام. الحمد لله رب العالمين. جزاكم الله خيرا.